three prisoners were sentenced to death. One of them French, one of them German, one of them American. "What is your last wish?" they ask the French guy. He says, "A bottle of exquisite French wine." "What is your last wish?" they ask the German guy. He says, "I want to give a speech." "What is your last wish?" they ask the American guy. He says, "I want to get shot before the German starts his speech." Unfortunately for you guys, it is too late now. This is my name, and this is to help the chairman pronounce my name. And my speech will be about deep learning. It's about 50 years old. And for most of these slides that I have here, I also have a website which has more details. You just click on it, it has usually an image on top which is similar to the one of the slides, and then you get all the details and papers, more than you want to read probably. Now the first guy, the first pioneer of deep learning 50 years ago was this man, Ivakhnenko. Ivakhnenko was from a place which is now called the Ukraine, and back then it was the Soviet Union. And what he had deep networks already in 65. What did he do? He had an input layer where the data was presented. And how many people in this room know something about neural networks? How many? Mm-hmm. Oh, quite a few. How many people do not know anything about neural networks? Mm-hmm. And do we have a third group here? He had a first layer of input neurons, which he didn't call input neurons, but that's what it was. And there he presented his data. And then he had a first layer of hidden neurons, or of nonlinear neurons, and they were connected to the input units. And each of them was able to compute a function of the inputs. And the function was a Kolmogorov-Gabor polynomial, which has multiplications and additions. And then he trained the whole system by regression, which is an old technique from the 1800s, Gauss and Legendre. And he trained it to predict data or to classify data. And if the first layer wasn't good enough, then he had another layer on top. And he trained that again by regression. And he kept adding layers until he could achieve good performance with the entire system. So each layer receiving a representation of the data, a transformed representation of the data, feeding it to the next one. And he also had a clever way of removing superfluous units. He pruned units away using something that today we would call a validation set. A validation set which he didn't use for training the system, but just for checking which of these many feature detectors is useful, improves performance, and which can be deleted. So he grew and shrank at the same time his network. What he didn't do was to train the entire system by backpropagation. Has anybody heard about backpropagation? All right. Has anybody not heard about backpropagation? Mm-hmm. Okay. So backpropagation is just a method for training deep, in principle, deep nonlinear networks like that. And so you have an error at the output layer, which is the difference between what the network should have said, according to the user, and what it really said. And then you change each weight in proportion to this gradient, and that is called gradient descent. And the way to implement it is called backpropagation. So you start at the output layers. There are errors which you can then propagate one layer back, and there all these units which are close to the output layer, they have some values in them which you can use then to further propagate errors all the way down until each of these connections and weights in the system knows how much did I contribute to the error and how much do I have to be changed to make a significant dent and improve the performance of the system. Now, backpropagation was invented in the same decade when Ivakhnenko did his thing in the 60s. who invented it. Again, you have a website just on that if you want, easy to find on the web. And just to summarize what was going on there, the first guys who invented backpropagation were Kelly and Bryson in the beginning of the 60s. And they didn't use neural networks, they used continuous control systems, but nevertheless they propagated errors already back then, back from one stage to the previous one in the way that is now called backpropagation. They used dynamic programming to derive what they were doing in the calculus of variations, which also goes back centuries. And then Dreyfus, in 1962, I think, found a way of deriving the same thing using only the chain rule, no dynamic programming. And the first guy who had modern backpropagation in discrete neural network-like systems with sparse connections and shortcut connections between different layers, that was Seppo Linnainmaa in 1970. He had a master thesis which told you, and which even had a Fortran program that did backpropagation in such graphs. But he didn't care for neural networks, and the first guy who applied backpropagation to neural networks was, in 1981, Paul Werbers. And then in the 80s, lots of people applied backpropagation to neural networks, and also there were extensions for recurrent neural networks where you have feedback connections, which are much more powerful than feedforward networks. Why? Because there you can implement memories of previously seen inputs of earlier parts of the speech signal, for example, that you are processing. And here I'm always citing people such as Werbers again, and Williams, and Robinson, and Falside. So these recurrent neural networks, they are the most general networks and the deepest of them all. So here we see a couple of input units, two input units, and then you see that each connection or each unit in this network is connected to all non-input units, which means that now with this recurrent network, you can process video, for example. In comes a video stream, and at every fraction of a second, a new video frame arrives, and that's encoded by the pixel intensities of the video at this point in time, and then a new frame arrives, and there come maybe 24 frames per second, and then some of these units that you see there are output units, which, for example, steering a controller, a robot, driving a car. And in between these hidden units, what do they do? Well, at every step in time, at every discrete time step, they just compute a weighted activation of those guys they are connected to at the previous time step. The program of such a recurrent network are the weights, the weight matrix. And it's a general program search that we are conducting as we are trying to find good weights, because recurrent networks are general computers, massively parallel, but also sequential computers, and any program that I can run on this laptop here, I can also run on a recurrent network with an appropriate weight matrix. So learning the program means adapting the weight matrix, and in the supervised case, this can be done through something which is called backpropagation through time, which is an extension of traditional backpropagation, where for every time step in the sequence you are processing, there is a new layer basically being constructed representing the activations of the system at this particular time step, and then you can use standard backpropagation to adjust these connections such that a better program is developed. And here we have a question.
You can pull this off the stand. Hold it.
And suddenly I'm mobile.
But keep yourself bounded between the middle section of these pillars.
All right.
Yeah, there we go.
That's excellent. Oh, that makes me much happier. Thank you. By the end of the 80s, it turned out that backpropagation in deep networks or in recurrent networks doesn't really work well. Deep learning doesn't really work. And in my first deep learning project, the goal was to figure out why. And the guy who analyzed the problem and mathematically derived the reason for this failure was this young man over there, Sepp Hochreiter, who in 1991 in his diploma thesis, showed that as you are propagating these error signals back, they become smaller and smaller from layer to layer. They become smaller and smaller, and they vanish exponentially in the number of layers. Sepp Hochreiter did this first in 1991. If you want to be a pioneer in this field, it helps if your first name is Sepp or Seppo or something like Seppo Linnainma, who had the first backpropagation in discrete networks. And then this insight drove much of our work in subsequent years, where we try to find solutions to this fundamental deep learning problem, as I like to call it. And one of them was use unsupervised pre-training for a whole hierarchy of networks, not just one, but a whole hierarchy. And each of these recurrent networks that you see there on the picture is a general computer, which just is trained in an unsupervised fashion to compactly reduce the sequence that it is observing, and then send up to the next level a more compact description of the observations, such that the next level has an easier task in figuring out additional spatiotemporal regularities, which then lead to an even more compressed representation of the data. And you go up the stack and hope that finally the top level has such a compact representation such that supervised learning on top of it, classification, recognition, speech recognition, whatever, becomes easier. And the way the whole system is set up is very simple. Each of these recurrent networks just tries to predict the next input given the previous history of inputs. And whenever there is an unpredictable input, then it represents new information, because all the predictable inputs, they are already contained somehow in the recurrent weights. Otherwise, I couldn't predict them. So I can send a compressed version of the sequence, which just consists of the unpredictable errors, but they are not errors, they are important information. I send that stuff up to the next level, which is then ticking on maybe a much slower time scale, where the fundamental deep learning problem is not as severe, and it may find additional regularities on this subsequent level, and so on. And so, in fact, each level of the hierarchy, as long as there's temporal predictability in the input stream, will find a shorter description length for the entire sequence. In other words, if you like the probabilistic language of machine learning, it will maximize the log probability of the observed sequences. And that is very similar to what in 2006 was then done in deep belief networks. Some of you may know what that is. Who knows deep belief networks? So there are some hands. Unsupervised pre-training can really greatly accelerate subsequent supervised learning. And then we could suddenly solve deep learning tasks that were unsolvable before, where you could assign credit across thousands of computational stages backward in time. You know, before I came here, I thought this is going to be just a little tech talk and there won't be much of an audience, but you guys are actually a large audience by my standards. The other day I gave a talk and there was just a single person in the audience. a young lady, and I said, young lady, it's very embarrassing, but apparently today I'm going to give this talk just to you. And she said, okay, but please hurry, I gotta clean up here. Now, also in the 1990s, we could completely replace this unsupervised hierarchy of recurrent networks by a single, purely supervised, discriminative neural network called the long short-term memory recurrent network, which could do many of the things that the unsupervised hierarchy of networks could do and more, because it wasn't limited by noisy inputs which are very unpredictable and which prevent the unsupervised sequence compression hierarchy from doing a good job. And the LSTM networks are very simple. Can you see a little arrow as I'm going here? Okay. So the LSTM networks are really simple. There's this red unit in the middle of each LSTM cell. And this red unit here is the simplest type of neuron that you can imagine. It is just a linear unit with a with an identity activation function. So the output is exactly what so f of x is x. Imagine that this connection from the unit to itself is 1.0. Ignore the blue dot and the stuff up here for a while. So there we have just a 1.0 connection and a unit which has a, an identity activation function, which means as we are propagating errors backwards through a unit like this, they don't change. They always get multiplied by 1.0 as they are traveling through the recurrent connection. Then they get multiplied by the derivative of the activation function, which is exactly 1.0. And this means that you can propagate these errors back for not only 10 or 100 or 1,000 steps, millions of steps. Of course, there are many things that you cannot learn with a linear network. So you have to surround, you have to surround it with a whole bunch of nonlinear units, a cloud of nonlinear units, and they will learn the nonlinear aspects of sequence processing. So as the errors are circling backwards in time, so to speak, in this red unit, they flow out also and enter these nonlinear, multiplicative or otherwise nonlinear units, and there they are used to change the weights such that the overall system performance improves. And this is the core of this long short-term memory idea, LSTM as it is called. And back then we just could do tiny little toy experiments with it, and we just could show that it can outperform hidden Markov models and similar devices on certain toy experiments just designed to show that. Today, this is used for all kinds of sequence applications, handwriting recognition, speech recognition. State of the art in speech recognition in many ways is now LSTM recurrent networks, and the big companies, Google and many others, are using it for their applications. I'm happy to have received all this funding from the German and from the Swiss National Science Foundations, without whom all of this would not have been possible. And they kept funding this also during the dark years, during the dark ages, from 1995 until 2003 or something, when most people did not look at neural networks anymore, but instead support vector machines, graphical models, and all kinds of devices. And when it was not possible to publish at the leading neural network conferences anything that had the word neural in the title. But things have completely changed, because most support vector machines, for example, they are just linear classifiers on top of something that is human-made, a kernel, which isn't changed anymore once it is defined, and the only adaptive part is linear, so it's very limited in many ways. Here we see a couple of guys who contributed to the LSTM networks, as Felix Gears, who invented good additional features of LSTM networks. Then here we have Alex Graves, my former PhD student, and then postdoc in my lab in Munich, first in Switzerland, then in Munich, and then he went on to the University of Toronto, Geoff Hinton's lab, and then he was bought later by some of the ex-students of my lab, who in the meantime had co-founded DeepMind, and now he's working for Google. Then here we have Dan Shirejan, who is doing mostly feed-forward networks. Also Uli Meyer was hired by Apple recently. Jonathan Maschi just finished his thesis. Alessandro Giusti, mostly working for image, on medical imaging, and Luca Maria Gambardella, who is my co-director of the Swiss AI lab, ITSIA, and he is famous for his work in swarm intelligence. So what can we do with these LSTM networks? One thing we can do is keyword spotting. Keyword spotting is when you listen to telephone speech and somebody says, Al-Qaeda. And a red flag goes up, and we were able to in 2007 for the first time to outperform our traditional competitors in speech recognition, hidden Markov models using LSTM networks. supported by the fact that computers kept getting faster and faster and faster, which means that all the theoretical advances of these LSTM recurrent networks more and more translated into practical applications. Luckily, this not only has military applications, such as the fight against terrorism or something, but it also has industrial applications, such as industrial espionage. And of course, you can also, and many people have done this, use it to predict the stock market from previous histories of data, sentiment analysis, previous stock market data, newspaper articles somehow represented and then fed into that to predict future data. And this might improve the performance of my investment advisor. The other day, my investment advisor, he called me and said, first, the good news, the money that you invested is still there, but it doesn't belong to you anymore. And then in 2009, for the first time, we started winning competitions with recurrent networks. That was the first time that a recurrent network really won a competition, where you have organizers that have a training set, which everybody can use for training, and then there's a secret test set, which is unknown to the public, and only the organizers then test on the test set how well are these methods doing that were trained on the public training set. And there was the connected handwriting recognition. Connected handwriting is kind of difficult because what you see here is to be willing to hear, that is the sentence that is written here, and then you translate that into a video, for example, as you're scanning the text and you feed it into the recurrent network step by step, while the old inputs are still circling around, and the output of the network should be this very short sequence, the label sequence, which is T, O, blank, B, E, blank, W, I, L, L, and so on. But normally, the teacher does not know where which letter begins and where which letter ends, so the segmentation and the recognition has to be done simultaneously by the network. And there's a way of doing this by maximizing the probability. I cannot get too close to these speakers. By maximizing the probability of the label sequences, of the short label sequences, given the long real valued input sequences. And there's a way of computing a gradient for that, which we published in 2006 at ICML, which is called connectionist temporal classification, and that's what you can use to train these LSTM networks then to perform handwriting recognition. And the system, through the work of Alex Graves, my former PhD student and then postdoc, was Alex Graves, he was able to win not only the Farsi handwriting recognition, but also the Arab handwriting recognition competition and the French handwriting recognition competition of the International Conference on Document Analysis and Recognition. Although none of us speaks a word of Arabic or Farsi, and our French is also not so good. And the very same system can be used for speech recognition. So you pipe in a long speech signal and out comes a label sequence, for example, phoneme recognition, or just plain letters of words where you represent words as letter sequences. And in between, the network has to learn everything, including how letters are related to each other, which letter sequences are plausible in English, which are not plausible, and translate this raw input stream, high-dimensional, long sequenced input stream into a short sequence of letters, words. And it looks like like HMMs are going to be phased out by this, although another application of HMMs is just use LSTM phoneme detectors, which are currently the best phoneme detectors, as features, and then use use traditional methods for HMMs to do the word recognition. So LSTM networks are now widely used, and I'm happy to report that back then, when we started this research, only tiny little toy experiments could be done. But of course, we are greatly profiting from the fact that every decade, computers are getting faster per Swiss franc by a factor of 100. Some tasks are so simple that you don't need a recurrent network to solve them. For example, when the symbols that you want to recognize are already segmented. And this is probably the most famous data set in machine learning, which was introduced by Jan LeCun and his team in 1989 at New York. Not yet at New York University, but not far from here. So these are handwritten digits, and you see that some of them are not so easy to recognize, even for humans. Now, one thing we did was not using a recurrent network, but just a standard, good old feed-forward backpropagation network, and that was done in 2010, and we just applied it to the good old MNIST data, which was used by many, many people before, using support vector machines or all kinds of alternative machine learning methods, and it was possible to just take plain old backpropagation, a method which back then was 50 to 30 years old, combined with another idea which was 20 years old, which is if you have particular patterns, then you can make additional training patterns out of it by just shifting it a little bit, or warp, or rotating it a little bit, or looking at it from the side. Just do all the things that your eyes are already doing anyway. And that's a way of making several training examples out of a single training example. And anybody who is using vision or computer vision or neural networks for computer vision is doing this, because it's the obvious thing that eyes and humans and biological organisms in general also do. Now, with digits, you can even warp a little bit the digits, and they still look like digits, but warping is not a good idea when it comes to rigid objects such as cars or ships or airplanes. And then with a seven-layer, multi-layer perceptron, no convolution, no unsupervised pre-training, just plain old backprop, 30 to 50 years old by then, we were able to break the record on the MNIST dataset, on the error rate of the MNIST dataset. And this, of course, was possible only through faster computers, and because we implemented all of this on GPUs, and what took a year of training on CPUs suddenly could be done in a single week because the factor we gained was about 15. And this prompted some people to say that the most important breakthroughs are not really the algorithmic breakthroughs or anything, but just the advances in computational hardware. But it's not quite true. There are also good additional ideas which also date back a long time, and what you really should use for feed-forward networks is something which is called a max-pooling convolutional neural network. Has anybody heard anything about a max-pooling convolutional neural network? Mm-hmm. So some hands are up there. It's again an old idea. We'll in a moment tell you something about the history of that. What you see here is the input image. Now, in this case, it's a 2, and then you have a first layer of convolutional neurons. What are they doing? Well, each of these neurons has a receptive field, which is a weight vector, essentially, and they are all actually using the same weight vector, and you shift this one neuron, if you will, across the entire scene such that a little patch is shifted from one place to the next, and for each input patch, you get some response, and then the activation or a sequence of activations, a two-dimensional array of activations, and the next layer, you call that a convolutional layer. And you can have not only one filter like that, but many different filters like that, but each filter set shares the same weights. And then you have a next layer, which is called a downsampling layer. A downsampling layer just takes the layer below, which has maybe 100 by 100 unit activations, real values, and then you downsample it such that it becomes, for example, a 50 by 50 array, and you replace each 2 by 2 submatrix by its maximum value. So that's how you downsample. Then you can have another convolutional layer, and another downsampling layer, and another convolutional layer, and another max pooling layer, and so on. And all, up there, you then try to classify something, and there's a difference between what the network should have done and what it really did, and you propagate this error back using good old backpropagation. And the history of that is long. It was Fukushima who, for the first time in 1979, proposed an architecture like that, based on neurophysiological studies by Hubel and Wiesel. This was called the neocogniton, where you had convolution, downsampling, convolution, downsampling, convolution, downsampling. And in 1992, Weng replaced the spatial averaging that Fukushima used for downsampling. He replaced that by max pooling. So the architecture, the max pooling convolutional neural network, was basically there in 1992. However, neither Fukushima nor Weng propagated errors through the whole system. They used unsupervised learning instead. And the guy who first propagated through a system like that, that was Jan LeCun in 1989. And he kept working with his group on improvements of systems like that, max pooling convolutional neural networks. And then if you apply that to interesting data, such as the Chinese handwriting recognition set, then you can get good results, even better than what you get if you apply plain standard backprop, as I showed you in the previous slide. So here we have Chinese characters, which are more interesting than the MNIST characters, because there are not only 10 different digits, but there are 4,000 different characters that you want to classify. And this means that your network really has 4,000 different output units. And then in 2011, our team was able to win the competition, the Chinese handwriting recognition competition, where the Chinese symbols were already segmented. So we didn't have the issue of segmenting or automatically segmenting the whole thing through a recurrent network. No, a feed-forward network, a deep max pooling convolutional neural network was sufficient to learn this. And then just last year, we were able to improve this further. And for the first time in 2013, we had almost human competitive performance on Chinese handwriting recognition. And this, of course, is interesting for all the smartphone companies, because what you want to do is you want to go to China. You don't understand Chinese. Well, you probably understand Chinese, but I don't. So I don't. I sit down in the restaurant, and there's a Chinese menu. And then I want to take out my smartphone and look at it, and it should recognize the symbols and then translate my options. So many cell phone companies are really interested in this. The same system can be applied to the MNIST data also, of course, which is now almost dead, which is too small by today's standards. But just for the fun of it, we did that. And for the first time in the history of MNIST, we were able to achieve 0.2% roughly, which is apparently human performance. So this is interesting, because within just a few years, we were able to improve a long-standing record, which had hovered around 0.4% for almost a decade. Suddenly, we were able to go down by almost 50%. Using, again, of course, a GPU implementation, which was first published in 2011 at the ICHCAI. And many people are using this system or similar systems now, similar GPU implementations. Now, if you look at the details of these networks, then you will discover that all these learning systems again and again reinvent things that have been known by computer vision experts for many decades. Namely, the external layers, the peripheral layers, which are close to the inputs, they usually, in vision tasks, become Gabor filters, orientation-sensitive edge detectors, sometimes on-center, off-surround detectors, off-center, on-surround detectors, things that you also know from biology. So, just because it's good to pre-process images like this, the system learns it again and again. Of course, what you can do is you can pre-train your system on a set of different data sets, vision data sets, and then just freeze the lower seven layers, and on top of that, just retrain quickly using new data, a new data set which has new previously unseen images, for example, and then you can learn much faster than if you had to train everything from scratch. So transfer learning and almost one-shot learning are possible now with such systems. It's all about compression, because what does a network have to do? Well, it has to take these billions of pixels and compress the relevant information down into a few million weights. So there's a huge compression going on, and of course the only way the system can do this compression is it can invent internal feature detectors which reflect the stuff that frequently occurs in the environment. For example, in an environment where there are many faces, then it's really efficient to have a couple of feature detectors which are really good at encoding prototype faces, and new faces that come in can be encoded by just encoding the deviations from the prototype face and stuff like this. So all this automatic creation of symbols from subsymbols, it's just an automatic byproduct of compression. One interesting application also in 2011 was the traffic sign recognition competition in Silicon Valley. And this is interesting because first, there was a qualifying round. There was a qualifying round where anybody in the world could download the training set from the organizers and then use his favorite machine learning algorithm to train and then submit the system to the organizers, and they would test it on a separate test set. And until the last day of the competition, our team thought we have a comfortable lead, but then Pierre Semane, who is sitting back there in the audience, and Jan Lecun from New York University, they submitted yet another entry. And it was slightly better than ours. And then Jonathan and Dan and Uli had to work late night to submit yet another entry, 1 hour or 2 hours before the deadline, just to reestablish the correct order. But then in the final competition, it was really clear. One has to say what was happening during the qualifying. Teams started overfitting on the test set, although they didn't have the test set. But you could repeatedly probe the test set by just submitting something. You would get a value back from the organizers. And so without knowing the test set, you would learn more and more about the test set. So it's possible to overfit on test sets even if you don't know them, if you just repeatedly probe them. And the organizers imposed a limit of 10 resubmissions when they figured out what was going on there. But then in the final competition, this was not the case. It was not possible to resubmit or whatever. There was a one shot, and there we had really a clear advantage. So our system then had 0.56% error rate on the traffic sign recognition task. The second best system was not a competitor, a machine learning competitor, it was humans. So human neural networks were about twice as bad as our system. And then the third entry was our colleagues and friends and the competitors from New York University. Now some of them hired by Facebook and others by Google. And then the fourth was the first method, which was not a neural network, but some other machine learning combination. And I think it was random forest plus support vector machine, something like this. You may have guessed that the Swiss AI lab where I'm working is located in Switzerland. And in Switzerland, if you don't obey a traffic sign, you go to jail. But across the border, there is Italy. In Italy, they also have traffic signs on the street, but only for purposes of decoration. Why are traffic sign recognition systems important for self-driving cars? And 2014, that's our current year, that's actually the 20-year anniversary of self-driving cars in highway traffic. And the guy who did it first was, of course, Ernst Dickmanns. Dickmanns in 1994. So before he did this in the 80s, he already had self-driving cars on empty streets without traffic, using huge machines like this, because the computers were so huge, you know. So you had to have a little truck there, a little van, just for the computers, which were state-of-the-art back then. But then in the 90s, computers got smaller, and he was able to have a car like this. And then 1994, 20 years ago, he was the first who had self-driving cars on highways. And this was around Paris, in the lane, in the multi-lane autobahn. And he was doing this without GPS, you know. Today, all the self-driving cars use GPS, but he did it without GPS. And he had active vision on board. He didn't use LIDAR or something or radar. He drove like humans. There were active cameras focusing on the salient points, tracking up to 5 cars in front of the vehicle, up to 5 cars behind the vehicle, going up to 180 kilometers per hour, which is more than 110 miles per hour, and automatically passing other cars. 20 years ago, much faster than today's self-driving cars, you know, much faster. And in 1995, he then had this legendary trip where his car went from Munich to Denmark and back on the highway, again up to 180 kilometers per hour, and often with over 100 kilometers of driving without any intervention of the safety driver. A safety driver had to be on board for legal reasons and also for unmodeled construction areas. Back then, however, traffic sign recognition and pattern recognition in general did not work well. So not work well in comparison to what we can do today. And I remember that in 1997, it was a big deal when IBM built a computer that beat the human chess champion. But back then in 1997, it was not possible to do pattern recognition, even in limited domains, in the same way that kids do it all the time. So in many ways, pattern recognition is computationally more challenging than chess. Interesting. The very same system then, in 2012, I think, became the first feed-forward system, deep learning system, that won an image segmentation contest. And the image segmentation contest was interesting because it was about little brain slices. So there are these huge human brain projects now in Europe and in the United States, and one of the things they are doing is they slice brains into little slices, and then they have an electron microscope that takes pictures, and then you get a stack of electron microscope images, and then from there you try to reconstruct the three-dimensional structure of the brain. And the way it is traditionally done is you have a horde of students, and they manually label all the pictures and say, this is background, this is membrane, this is synapse, background, membrane. It takes forever. So you want to automate this, and that's why they had competitions like this. And what you see on the left is a typical slice like that, and then there are students who label it, and what we can do is we can train our deep networks to imitate the labels of the students. For each pixel, basically, you say, is that background or neuron or whatever it is, taking into account the entire context around this image. So I'm careful. I'm saying this was the first image segmentation contest won by a feed-forward deep learner. However, in 2009 already, we had these recurrent LSTM networks, which did both the segmentation and the recognition at the same time. And exactly the same system then was also the first that won an object detection contest. And the object detection task was rather challenging and important. It was about medical imaging. There you get huge. So what you see here on these slides are breast scans. And the idea is you find among all these cells that you see there a few cells which might be pre-cancer cells, mitosis cells as they are called. And normally you have to have a trained histologist who says this is a mitosis cell and this is harmless and this is harmless and so on. And you would like to model the expert histologist, you would like to have a system that imitates that and does it automatically. So what you do is you train your object detector on certain patches where you have labels given by a trained histologist. And then you shift this thing across the entire image, and whenever it lights up, then you say there is a mitosis cell. Now, I'm not able to see the difference between a mitosis cell and others. It's kind of subtle. It takes a long time to understand the difference, apparently. But our networks can learn these differences just by being exposed to many training samples. And this was in 2012. And then the same system was able also to win the next competition of this type because it's so important. There are several competitions along these lines. Deep learning in 2013 for the MIKAI Grand Challenge on mitosis detection, where you had an even bigger data set. Why is this stuff important? Well, the world economy is about $60-70 trillion, and 10% is for healthcare, so about $6-7 trillion, and quite a fraction of that is really for medical diagnosis. But it's not only a commercially interesting thing. Also think about the fact that there are many, many people in the world who have no access to decent healthcare at all. And through systems like that, maybe we can achieve a situation where some expert analysis, to a certain extent in collaboration with doctors who are supervising the whole procedure, becomes available to a much larger fraction of the world population. So that would be nice. How many more minutes do I have? Do I have a limit at all? I don't really have a limit, right? Yeah, so. Yeah, there's a question.
I'm curious what kind of error rate one.
Yeah, so the error, there are several ways of measuring the errors there, but let me just say it is not quite as good as the expert histologist. However, we had another paper where we trained non-experts on exactly the same training data that we used for training the neural networks, and there, on average, the network was better than the humans who were trained on that.
Yeah.
So, yeah. However, one should also take into account that we are imitating a histologist who also may not have ground truth. Because ground truth you get only through autopsy afterwards, you know, after the fact. So we are also trying to imitate basically the faults of the trained histologists, which may have its own limitations. What we really want to do is, of course, not only pattern recognition, and everything I've said so far was about pattern recognition, but you want to perceive and act and perceive and act. You want to build a real artificial intelligence that interacts with the world, that predicts the world through a world model, and then uses this prediction to optimize behavior. Like these little guys that you saw, and this is an old movie, 10 years ago, 2004, when the head of my robot lab, Alexander Förster, was the leader of the FU team in the RoboCup, which won the championship, the world championship in the Fast League, which back then already was so fast that a human expert with a joystick could not win against the best teams. And each of these little robots there has four motors, and there is a neural network controller which has learned to send control signals to the motors, and there's another model of the world which predicts what's going to happen if I send this control signal, given this history of inputs, to the robot. And then you can use the world model to plan ahead future action sequences. You go tick, 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 tick. There's one thing you can optimize. You can optimize the action sequences that you're going to execute, and then you can optimize towards certain sub-goals, like, for example, rapidly approach the ball, but then break in time until such that you don't bump the ball away or such that you don't run into an opponent. The global behavior back then was not reinforcement learned. This was generated by a human, but then these little sub-goals, they were all the time optimized using neural networks. Let me show you one final application, which goes back to one of the first slides. Here now we really have a recurrent neural network which is completely random in the beginning and which is trained to drive a car in a video game simulation. And it's trained to do this by receiving raw video input. So there's an input stream, and as you are interacting with the video game, you get new frames and the car is making movements. It can accelerate, brake, shift, it can steer. And this, of course, causes new inputs. And then there's a program running on the recurrent network, which is its weight matrix. And you want to find a program that drives the car as quickly as possible for as long as possible. There is no teacher who tells the system what to do at which time, which means there is no supervised learning. We cannot use backpropagation through time or anything like that. The system has to invent also the output sequences, the output actions. This is a general reinforcement learning task. This is a general thing that you really want to do in artificial intelligence. You want to build a reinforcement learner that maximizes future expected reward given the previous experiences with the world. And so there's this big recurrent network which has a million weights, and there's no teacher who knows what it should do and who tells the system what it should do at which point in time. And it does not know anything about vision. It has to learn all vision by itself. And it actually learns to see as this car. Yes, there's a question.
In these neural networks, do you see them creating edge detectors or mimicking the biological evidence that we see in living organisms? Or does that not happen? And it's completely a alien intelligence in that it's not, doesn't have the similar characteristics as our biological
system. So the question is, do these artificial neural networks come up with the same feature detectors as biological neural networks? And talking about the feed-forward networks that I mentioned before, this is in many ways certainly the case. So the periphery of these networks is very similar to what you find also in biological systems. Gabor filter, I mentioned this before. And then deeper in there, you have more complex, more compact feature detectors. But some of them become grandmother neurons. Others have more distributed representations. It really depends on the statistics of the scene. However, the visual system of our artificial agent is, in many ways, maximizing the same objective that biological systems are maximizing, which means it is forced to come up with the same good feature detectors through compression, through compressing the frequently occurring things down into a few units that represent what is appearing again and again in the visual scene. And so, of course, you get predictive models of what neuroscientists will find in the future. You just look at our deep artificial neural networks, you look at the seventh layer, and then you say, well, these feature detectors here are probably, and now the question is, are they really, the question to the neuroscientists, are they really, can you find such feature detectors in animal brains or in human brains? And at the moment, it's not clear whether they are the same, because neuroscientists do not know how to read off synapse strengths in a good way. So our artificial systems are making predictions about what neuroscientists will find in the future. Now, I don't know much about brains. I don't know what brains do. I just know what they should do. And so we are trying to take this and build artificial agents that just follow optimality principles such that they optimize their performance in the world, assuming that animals are also doing similar things. Now here, the compressed network search is now really about a recurrent network which is completely unstructured, which learns to drive the car, and it has a million weights. And some of you may know that people occasionally evolve, use evolution methods for evolving recurrent networks like this. And the idea is that you use Darwinian evolution to come up with better and better weight matrices in cases where there is no supervising teacher, in cases where you cannot apply backpropagation through time, where you have the more complex problem of also inventing appropriate output actions. This is really learned to drive from raw vision a video game controller. That was the first time that something like that was done. And how was it done? Well, since you cannot evolve big programs for recurrent neural networks, what you do is instead we are searching in a much more compressed space of programs that compute the big weight matrices. So we have a little programming language which allows us to encode huge programs such as recurrent network weight matrices within just a few bits of information. And what we do is then we use the programs that we are generating there, translate them into weight matrices, test them in the environment. If they are not better than the best so far, then we discard them. Otherwise, we reward the program that computed the big weight matrix and make it and increase its probability of being reused in future searches. So, evolutionary computation in this reduced space, if you will. A long time ago, 20 years ago, I had an assembler-like programming language for encoding big weight matrices, always trying to implement this Occam's razor principle, which is if you have 10 different ways of solving a problem, always go for the simplest one. If you have 10 different ways of explaining the data, always go for the simplest one. Simplest always means shortest, fewest computational resources. Back then, this assembler-like program was not very natural. This programming language was not very natural to deal with tasks such as vision and so on. What we are using today is something else. Imagine the weight matrix, maybe 1,000 times 1,000 weights, is an image. Now use your favorite image compression algorithm to compress it down to a few bits. Use wavelet decomposition, use Fourier decomposition. What we actually do is use discrete cosine transform decompositions. Now we have a little programming language which takes DCT coefficients as basic instructions, and then we first try, can we come up with a short program, maybe just 10 DCT coefficients that computes a big weight matrix, which we then test and evaluate in the video game. If it doesn't work, then we double, then we have 20, and then we double again, 40, 80, until suddenly, for the first time, we are having success, and then we know now we are in the right ballpark, and we keep further optimizing. This is what's happening here, and then it really learns to drive the car through a huge program of 1 million weights, which, however, can be compressed down to just a few DCT coefficients. So, in fact, it is listed here, the torx driving procedure, that's what we are looking at here. We have 64 by 64 vision input, a sequence of that. The recurrent network does not know anything about vision, but it comes up with weights over time that do the memory, the vision, and everything. And you can encode this complex program within just 200 DCT coefficients. So we have a compression of 1 to 5,000. And there's another question.
What was the objective function? Does the car go until it crashes, or is there like a continuous stream of information, like if you're on the tracker?
Yeah. There were very few things, but essentially it's go as far as possible, as quickly as possible before crash. So you try to maximize the time and the length before crash. Very simple. So from this stupid simple feedback, you want to extract knowledge about how to do vision. Yeah? That's kind of almost crazy, but it did work here, because it turns out that the program that does it looks complex because the 1 million weight matrix looks complex, but no, it's not complex because I can compress it down into just 200 DCT coefficients. So an extreme form of the Occam's razor principle.